Hello, I'm Barbara Peters. Welcome to this episode of the Criminal Calendar. We have a special event today. William Tapley, myself, and at some point during the proceedings, the ghost of a very dear friend, author Philip A. Craig, and we'll tell you why that's going to happen. But I wasn't there, Bill, when you published Death at Charity's Point, but I was there when Poison Pen Press republished Death at Charity's Point. How long ago was that?
When you republished it? Oh, it was 12, 15 years ago? Does that sound right? It was one of the first, before you became a really big, important publisher.
Before we became a real publisher. Actually, yours was one of the first four books that we published in kind of a nice little mass market.
It was, and I wrote a special introduction for it, looking back on
you did
having actually written a second book after having written the first book. Yeah.
And you originally published in 1984, so it was your first published novel?
Yep.
And our good friend, yours and mine, Suzanne Kirk,
yes,
the editor at Scribner, with her incredibly eagle eye, picked you out and published your
first mystery. Well, that's not technically true.
No?
It was a young editor named Betsy Rappaport, who was Suzanne Kirk's assistant or something like that. So it's fair to say, and I think Suzanne would remember it that way too, that Betsy discovered me. I'd worked with both of them, but mostly with Betsy when I was with Scribner's.
How many books did Scribner's publish of the Brady Coyne series?
Maybe seven or eight or six or something.
I'm trying to remember, because when I opened The Poison Pen in 1989, you were, if I look at my cheat sheet here, you were up to Dead Winter and Client Privilege.
All right,
but you'd already shifted
publisher. That was with Delacorte at that point, yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, tell me about how it felt to be picked out of the slush pile, so to speak, by Betsy Rappaport.
It was astounding. I mean, there's a story that goes with that. Which, as you know, Scribner's was ultimately bought out by Macmillan and all of that stuff that was going on in the publishing world. And Betsy, my editor, called me up and said, you better come down here and see the Scribner's building. For some reason, I'd been down in New York a lot, but I hadn't been to the Scribner's building. And it was a historic building, and they were going to make a drugstore out of it. So I went down on a Saturday, no one was there, and first floor was the Scribner's bookstore.
I remember that. It had a gallery, didn't it, the way around with a beautiful metal railing.
All this wood and mahogany and old
That's
leather
right.
and cigar smoke stain and stuff like that. And up on the second floor were the offices, and she showed me where Maxwell Perkins edited Thomas Wolfe and Hemingway and all that. And
no pressure there.
But what astounded me, what struck me more than all that, was the fact that on that second floor, the editorial offices, everywhere you looked, there were stacks of manila envelopes. I mean, thousands and thousands and thousands of them in every corner, on every desk, and on the floor, on the chairs. I said to Betsy, I said, is that what I think it is? She said, yes, that's the hopes and the dreams of tens of thousands of aspiring novelists in the world. And I said, what happens to those? And what happened to them was something really scary, like every Friday afternoon some undergraduate English majors from Hunter College would come in and be loaded up with them and take them home for the weekend, bring them back on Monday and tell one of the actual employees at Scribner's if any one of those struck them in any way as being interesting.
Wow.
I said, well, what about me, you know? And she said, well, Betsy, became my editor. She said, well, yours happened to be in one of my pile one weekend. And I happened to be looking for a semi-hard-boiled male da-da-da-da, whatever she saw in my book, she said. I mean, there was a long, winding road between that and getting published. I had to rewrite the whole thing. It struck me, and of course you know this as well as I do now in your business, how many people are writing novels?
How many people are writing novels and how much luck is involved? But you know, that day of the big slush pile is largely gone today. This is why literary agents have become, just as in sports, you know, the agent really is kind of directing Well, you're a big baseball fan. We both know that. And by the way, I noticed a
yes,
line.
Yes, from Boston.
Yeah. Yeah, but I noticed a line in One Way Ticket where you refer to the 2004 season. And of course, by now, your comment.
I was unable to refer to the 2007 season since the book came out in September of this year.
That's right. But it's funny how, you know, the Red Sox, in fact, we have a book publishing next summer, and it's called The Green Monster, and it's a book about the Red Sox and Fenway, and he had to rewrite it, part of it, and he said to me, I don't know what to do, I want the Sox to win on the other hand, I don't want to rewrite the book, but I think that couldn't really happen to you today, that serendipity, that you were in the right pile of someone.
Oh, no, I'd have to go try to get an agent. That's, absolutely.
Which is harder sometimes than actually getting published, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know about that. I know, all I know is that's what I tell people, you know, at some point you've got to look for an agent because that's who the publishers mostly deal with now.
It is.
And they're the, you know, they sort them out. Someone has to.
So, Brady Coyne, your guy, what was the genesis of Brady Coyne? He's a lawyer, and he's a Boston Brahmin lawyer, which sort of means he prefers to cater to the rich.
Well, I'm a little embarrassed almost to say this, because I teach writing, and I try to guide people and so forth, but he really just evolved as I was writing a book. I mean, I paid no attention to who he was. I was writing Death at Charity's Point. I was calling it Charity's Point. I don't think it's a better title, but anyway. And I had a first-person narrator, and when I started with a first-person narrator, I wasn't sure who was narrating. I liked the voice, so I kept going, and pretty soon I said, who is this guy? I'll make him the lawyer. I knew my story. I'll make him the lawyer. Okay, he's a lawyer. What's his name? And I had written a terrible short story a year or two earlier in which a very minor character was a lawyer named Brady Coyne. I said, well, okay, Brady Coyne, I'll use it for now. And writing along, and this is literally true, at some point in the story early on, he had to go home. Well, where does he live? I didn't know. I said, all right, we'll put him down on the waterfront. And I knew it was a Boston story. And who lives with him? All right, he lives alone. Divorced, single, what's the story? I'll make him divorced, that'll be fun. You know, and that's how it evolved. I mean, no one should do it that way.
I'm not sure that authors don't do it that way more often than you think. One of the things, the salient things about Brady is his fondness for fishing, which certainly is you. I mean, whenever that goes on, I really hear your voice.
Well, I mean, that was another one of those little decision things at the time, and it's actually in the prologue to Death at Charity's Point. So it's within the first two or three pages, he's fishing. And part of me was thinking, well, you got to give somebody a hobby. You know, he's got to have interests. And you can either give him interests that you don't know anything about, in which case you got to do a lot of research, or you can give him interests that are your interests. And then it's easy to write about them. So that's how he became a fisherman. This because I was a fisherman, it was easy to write it. It occurred to me pretty quick that fishing, or at least fly fishing for trout, which is what I do mostly, is not too much unlike investigating crimes.
Right. I mean, there's kind of a nice metaphor there.
Yeah. I try not to do metaphors, but you know, it does kind of work that way. That you know, when something is troubling him, he'll go fishing. He'll sit by the river and he'll watch the water go by and try to figure out where the fish might be and what they might be eating and that kind of thing, and use the clues that are available to him. And that's what detectives do too.
Well, your detective does. There's a lot of patience involved and a lot of observation. I mean, Brady is not a high-tech, razzle-dazzle, martial arts kind of
No, sleuth. He's not. And that's just how he is. I mean, it wasn't that I decided he's going to be kind of laid back and so forth. That's how he came out of my imagination.